Darkcast Network. Welcome to the dark side of podcasts.
There is no greater gift that you could give to yourself than to get healthy. Welcome back. This is True Crime Connections, and I'm your host, Tiffany. Joining me this week is Kristin Rivas. She is here to share with us her very important message, and that's how powerful words truly are. Words literally saved Kristin's life. Stay tuned to find out how you can also transform your life.
Well, thank you so much for being here, Kristin. I was so admired by your story. It actually brought some tears to my eyes a little bit.
Thanks for having me, Tiffany. You're not the first person to have told me that.
I'm sure.
It's not like I intended to make everybody cry from hearing me say something or sharing my story, but at least I've gotten feedback that they were good tears of like being, impressed and relieved that I'm better now.
For sure. So let us begin so our listeners know exactly what we're talking about. I will give you the floor.
All right. Well, probably a useful place to begin is the fact that I gave a TEDx talk in 2013 to share how rapid resolution therapy, this modality that not that many people have heard of, it's also been known as rapid trauma resolution therapy or clinical hypnosis, dynamic clinical hypnosis with rapid resolution therapy. This modality helped me overcome PTSD, a condition that today is known as functional neurological disorder. When I got diagnosed with it back in 2009 by the Mayo Clinic in Jacksonville, Florida, it was called conversion disorder. So what that means is that the body has had a reaction to trauma and stress in such a way, like how some people develop panic attacks, it causes non-epileptic seizures. So I used to have non-epileptic seizures that resembled, it would look like somebody having a grand mal kind of seizure or different kinds of seizures. And I used to have them up to 9 times a day. And I was in a wheelchair wearing a helmet. So for safety reasons, because medication didn't make them stop. There was nothing anybody could do to prevent them or stop them once they started happening. And I struggled with that for almost 2 years. They suddenly struck when I was maybe my junior year, I think, now of college. And I had been laughing and talking with a friend of mine who had been a roommate. We were in the campus dormitory of my college, like doing laundry. And we were laughing and chatting. And that's when I had my very first episode of, again, what today would be called functional neurological disorder, or FND for short. And at first, my eyes like went cross-eyed and started moving weird, and I felt lightheaded. My tongue felt swollen and numb. I felt like somebody having a stroke. Like I knew that my friend was talking to me, speaking in English, but it was somehow I didn't understand her and I couldn't understand what to say back to her. And then I ended up, oddly, even though I was conscious, I went blind. I couldn't see even though my eyes were open. And then I went unconscious. And when I woke up, I was seizing. And so I went to the ER, and the symptoms were happening off and on for a couple of hours while they gave me tests. A week or two before, I had again, been trying to do laundry, and I got an iron out of a closet, and an iron had fallen on my head. But they checked me out, and I didn't have a concussion. Like, they did an MRI, they checked my heart and stuff like that. They gave me tests for having epileptic seizures, and I wasn't reading as having a seizure or anything like that. So every single test they gave me to check different organs of my body, my blood, they said, everything's negative. Nothing is showing as abnormal. It's possible that what just happened was a result of stress. I was like, what? So that episode that kind of lasted on and off for almost a few hours that night, and then the ER sent me home and said, basically, we know that you have a job. We know that you're a very busy person taking a full credit, semesters at school, 4.0 straight A student, working. I was in Army ROTC at the time. I had a very full life, but they were like, oh, and I was also a newlywed back then. And they're like, yeah, so like, just try not to get stressed. They sent me home. But then, you know, right? Like, episodes happened again the next day. Within 1 week, I was having them up to 3 times a day. And so I had to drop out of school. And so then they started escalating to up to 9 times a day. Every time I went to an ER when I was having the episodes, again, they would say nothing is technically wrong. But they gave me anti-anxiety medication. They gave me antidepressant medication, anti-seizure medication. And I went on a waiting list for the Mayo Clinic, a research hospital. Have you ever seen that show House? Like with, yes, Hugh Laurie? They're like detectives trying to figure out what the heck is wrong with somebody. So I had to wait for months to be accepted by the Mayo Clinic for them to do more like specialized nuanced testing. And then I would have to wait sometimes 1 month, 3 months to see specialized doctors with specialized tests. During that time, sometimes I would have these episodes without being able to tell what the heck set it off. I mean, it happened sometimes in the middle of the night while I was sleeping.
Were you dreaming about laundry? Because I see a key with laundry.
Laundry so much. Apparently I didn't like laundry. No. There was a couple of certain triggers. So like one was seeing things zoom in or out real quick. So have you ever seen the show The Big Bang Theory?
Oh my god, I know it word for word like a dork.
Yeah, right. You know, at the beginning when they like, you know, they show the universe being created or something, that could cause me to have a seizure. So back then they didn't have on TV or at the beginning of movies, like for photosensitive viewers, this may, you know, cause seizures or something. So it could just happen out of the blue there. If I took steps backwards, or somebody moved my wheelchair backwards, or if I was in a car and it reversed, it would set off the episodes. And then I started to develop this symptom called, catalepsy and catatonia, which is like the muscles from having like a seizure starting to freeze, like have paralysis while contracted. So if you can imagine somebody in the midst of having a seizure and then their body freezes that way, and then it won't unlock for a while, like 20 minutes or an hour or something like that. It's very painful. So this whole time the Mayo Clinic was saying, you know, while we're testing you for multiple sclerosis or brain parasites, because you've spent some time in Africa doing missions trips and stuff like that, we're also recognizing that there's a possibility that this could be because of actually like PTSD, trauma, because my sister had died 3.5 years earlier before my first episode. She had died from a drunk driver. And my sister, Bethany Rivas, was 15 months older than me. Firstborn child of our family. I also have a brother that's 6 years younger than I am. But people used to think me and my sister were twins. We just were close in age, looked similar. And actually, on March 6th, So 2 days ago from before us recording this, it was the 19th anniversary of my sister's death from a drunk driver. But I had handled her death by being extremely busy, like keeping myself from thinking about it. Like I hated stillness and silence. So I packed my schedule and to try to be exhausted at night so I could fall asleep quickly without having to see images from the court trial to prosecute the drunk driver of like the scene of the crash and stuff like that. And I would wake, I would have nightmares and I would wake up pretty disturbed because I, in the nightmares, I was trying to save my sister from dying. She died in a new and different way, sometimes up to 3 times a night. It was like Groundhog's Day. It's awful. But, and then I would wake up and I would have like morning nausea, which was like excess cortisol. I didn't know it at the time, but it was like being in hypervigilance, survival mode, and not, but I was functional. Like I was keeping up with all my responsibilities. And I was, if people said, "Hey, Kristin, how are you doing about that? You know, how are things okay?" I would be like, "Well, you know, you can't change anything." Because it was like, for me, I was thinking, well, if I didn't really go there and think about what things disturbed me, if I tried to distract myself and focus on other things, then that was good for me. Because it, to me, it made sense that if something really bad and disturbing and upsetting had happened, it would be understandable for there to be some stuff that you're just going to have to live with for the rest of your life. So I didn't really know that, like, I was actually having symptoms of what could be qualified as like PTSD with like insomnia or early awakening in the middle of the night or repetitive nightmares, and then having the morning nausea and like a loss of appetite, that that was like a sign of my body being in fight, flight, freeze almost 24/7, including even like trying to distract myself from talking or thinking about how I felt over my sister's death. Because the drunk driver was a repeat offender, and the laws are stricter today. But back then, when she died in 2005, Stephen Michael Johnson, he had 14 DUIs and a revoked license. He had a revoked license, so he basically got behind the wheel of somebody else's car to go get more alcohol. she had been at a birthday party. Her friend Crystal Fisher was also, she also died in the car crash. And then we found out at the in the court trial for prosecuting the guy, and by the way, nobody like prepared me that this was going to happen. They don't tell the family sitting there, you know, like, by the way, we're about to share some really disturbing stuff today. It was just, you attend the court trial. And that happened 2 years after Bethany died, that the court trial was now finally happening. And I found out that he had made 11 phone calls at the scene of the crash on a cell phone to try to get friends and family to pick him up so he could flee it while my sister was still trying to hold on for life, bleeding out on the side of the road. And if he had maybe called sooner, you know, like... Right. Maybe
did
medical.
Did he ever call 911?
No.
He never... None of them?
Somebody else, and somebody who lived near the area ended up calling 911, having heard the crash, the car like go into a telephone pole. And so that messed with me, even though it was like ripping open a scab years later. And I mean, it really messed with my mind and provoked me to think all these thoughts, like what if, and anger and stuff like that. But I had been raised a pastor's daughter and knew that it didn't serve me to be angry. I tried to pray it away. I tried to read scripture, but I couldn't help that I still felt a bunch of anger, and that in my dreams, I had dreams of like biting him and hurting him and like really primal rage, right?
That's
understandable. So, anyway, like the Mayo Clinic was aware that it, like these symptoms could possibly be just trauma, right? And I, by the time they had given me every test they could think of over the course of like almost 2 years, maybe it was like 18 months or so, by the, because I had been on a waiting list to start seeing them. They officially gave me that diagnosis of conversion disorder. And they said, well, because we have already sent you to like six different therapists and you've been on anti-anxiety and antidepressant medication, and yet your symptoms have been escalating the whole time, with somebody that's had this kind of treatment resistance, the prevalence, the frequency of your symptoms, there's about a 20% chance that you could recover in your life. Like, you might have to live with this, but there is another therapy that we haven't tried, and that's like hypnotherapy. It gets good results for this particular thing. And so thankfully a friend of my family had stopped smoking because of rapid resolution therapy. And this guy loved cigars, loved cigars, but he knew that they were unhealthy. And so he had seen the founder, Dr. John Connolly, of rapid resolution therapy, and had knocked that out in one session. And he told my parents, this guy actually specializes in helping people clear trauma. Like, that's his main thing. He just helped me to stop smoking. But maybe there's tons of testimonials on his website, rapidresolutiontherapy.com. You can also find it if you say cleartrauma.com. And so we looked at it and we saw all these testimonials of people that had experienced very, very serious trauma. I'm talking a firefighter from 9/11 whose stuff had cleared up. War veterans, people that experienced multiple sexual assaults, gang rape, childhood molestation, and all this kind of stuff. And he was getting amazing results with people. And he trained mental health professionals. So even though we were like, you know, as a Christian family, like, hypnosis, I don't know, like, what could happen? but it was like, everybody was getting good results. And everybody said that they didn't get demon possessed, and they were fine. So decided to give it a try. And so on June 20th of 2009, my dad had driven me to go have a session with him. And I left my four-pronged cane and my helmet in the car because I was self-conscious about it. And I was like, also, I really, really want to not have to have these anymore. And like, almost like as an act of intention or faith or whatever you want to call it, I was like, I'm going to leave these in the car and just walk in there. Right. And I could describe the experience as like a 2-hour and 20-minute life-changing conversation. The first 2 hours, my eyes were open during the whole process. And Dr. John Connolly, like, first thing he said was, what would you like to get done today? And to be honest, there was never a therapist that I had worked with before that had ever implied we could actually get something done, let alone in one session in one day. So that was unusual. And I was like, well, I think I could really use some assistance in clearing up some very disturbing thoughts and feelings, because obviously my body hasn't been handling it well. I'd really like my nervous system to get regulated, you know, this involuntary movement stuff, you know, stopping. So that would be great. And he was like, okay, well, tell me what kind of disturbing emotions have you been dealing with? I was like, well, grief, you know, like sadness, anger, fear. And then he asked me, just give me a little hint of what kinds of thoughts or things, like a memory or a thought or what, you know, you've been imagining that has been triggering those specific feelings. Like, so I didn't have to go into nasty, horrible detail and spend, you know, the whole time talking about things that were very disturbing to me. He just got like a brief, like made sure that he understood what I meant in the quickest, most comfortable way possible. Like, get a sense of it, right? And then he was like, yeah, I can do something for that. And it's my intention that our time be like enjoyable and highly valuable and effective, that you experience stuff being automatically different for you after our time here together today. And by the way, that's my total job. That's what I'm trained for, have the skill set, expertise for. And that's what I take responsibility for, is to make something valuable happen for you that you're happy and satisfied with over time. Like, would that be okay? I was like, well, yes. But he actually checked in a more interesting way. He's like, well, would it be okay, really, to be okay now? Like, would it be okay to not be angry anymore? Would it be okay to not be sad anymore about what happened? Like, even if something that totally wasn't okay, it's like very, excuse my, is it okay to cuss here?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I don't, like, if something very fucked up happened, awful happened, like, would it be okay for you to be okay, even though that thing wasn't okay?
Weird question, because when you think about it, some people don't know if they want to get rid of what is holding them back. It's almost like you're afraid to be well because you had been so sick for so long.
Well, I'm just lucky that he actually bothered to ask that within like the first 5 minutes of our session. He was like, well, say it out loud. It's okay for me to not be angry anymore. And immediately I was like, yeah, it feels, even though I want to be okay and I want to be well, it doesn't feel true to say that. He was like, okay, like, let's start there. So he started with getting permission to clear up the feelings. And he kind of gave me some ideas of thinking, some ways of thinking, kind of going, hey, I found this way of thinking to be useful about how our minds and bodies were built to work, why we have these kinds of emotions, what the subconscious mind is trying to get us to do when these emotions get triggered. He compared humans to animals, used examples. He's very entertaining. A lot of it was like, really how we put things was very simple and easy to understand and funny. So I was like laughing most of the time. And a lot of what he said just made sense to me. And he would check and say, does that make sense that we think of things that way, more like this? And I'd be like, yeah, that makes sense. And I noticed throughout the session that the emotions were starting to disappear, like fear, anger, grief, even guilt. I had felt guilty that I, for instance, my sister had come out to see my boyfriend at the time, my boyfriend be in a play, and she had hung out with me like that night. And at the end of that Friday night, I had said, hey, can we hang out again this weekend? I'm, you know, visiting back from college. I'd like to hang out with you again before I go back to college. And she was like, well, I'm going to a fair tomorrow, like a county fair. And then I have a friend's birthday party on Sunday night. So I don't think that we're going to have time this time, but like rain check, right? See you later, alligator. After a while, crocodile. Those were our last words to each other. And in my mind, I had been going, well, I should have hung out with her again. I should have made her hang out with me. Something bad happened. I must have been bad. Like, it was, if only I had hung out with her or something, this wouldn't have happened, right? And Dr. Connolly even helped clear up that guilt, you know, and again, took it as his responsibility to cause that to happen for me by kind of convincing me, by giving me some different ways of thinking about things and taking me through almost like a verbal exercise where he had me repeat some things after him to check and see how it felt to say it. And it like integrated it, aside from like a logical way, down into almost like an emotional, physical way. Like, I started to notice things shifting throughout the conversational experience. And then he finished it up. Like, the last 20 minutes is when he basically kind of concluded the session with giving my mind a different way of processing everything that I had just heard, where my eyes were closed, and he encouraged me to like rest deeply. Kind of what people may have heard of referred to as, you know, hypnosis, trance, some people could call it an alpha brainwave state that happens during meditation and stuff like that. I was fully conscious, very aware. I felt more peace than I had in years. I felt very clear, very aware. And I noticed that my eyelids started rapidly fluttering, almost like what happens during, I forget what stage it is of sleep, where you're dreaming or something like that.
Right?
Yeah, REM sleep. It was like that, even though I was awake. And I felt like a warmth in the back of my head, which was interesting. It was like I was aware that something was happening, almost like watching your computer, like processing, like the computer is getting hotter and it's making a whirring sound like or something like that, running a program. And he was like, your mind is just integrating everything that we're saying and is clearing stuff up. It's clearing the patterns of what have been happening for you, disturbing thoughts and feelings, disturbing reactions in your mind and body. And it's organizing towards like clarity and peacefulness and presence and gratitude and love for your sister rather than grief. A continued connection with your sister, feeling connection with her just at the thought of how grateful you are to know her and everything that you've learned about her and love for her and everything like that. It basically, like, the grief is disappearing and the anger is disappearing and like, and you get peace and you get hope and you healthier. And I felt better and better and better. Like, and then he said, when your mind is like done, like making all of that make sense and getting better, like boop, eyes will open. Don't try to make them open on purpose. Don't try to prevent them from opening. When your mind has made the adjustment you came in here to make today, eyes will open. And it was so, I tried to open my eyes. I like disobeyed. It's like, and they stuck. And it was like, it wasn't done. And then what was so weird is it was like bing, a few seconds later and like a microwave door opening and my eyes open. And I literally could notice like brain fog had lifted. I could see clearer, like color was sharper. My sense of smell was clearer. And I immediately felt like more sturdy and like grounded and centered in my body. Like calm in my body, and I felt like more like alert and refreshed, but not like anxious alert. I'm talking like, I don't know, on like your best day after you've worked out kind of alert. And I felt like just different, and I felt happy. I was like a fog had lifted, and immediately I was like, ooh, I want to test this out. So I like ran around the office backwards and I didn't have a seizure. And then I, he was like, let's show your dad. And I ran around my dad backwards. And I was like, look, dad, no hands. You know, like, I have been able to do that in like 18 months at least without flopping around like a fish for at least 20 minutes. And so, I mean, me and my dad, like, and I think Dr. Conley, we all cried tears of joy. And we're like, well, I guess we're done. And what was so interesting was like the next day, I woke up from sleep. I was at my parents' house. And I noticed like a hint. If we could say on a scale of like 0 to 100%, maybe like somewhere between like 5% of this like cloudy, sad feeling as I was like drifting into conscious awareness, opening my eyes that morning. And I heard thoughts in my head just automatically happening that were saying, where's Bethany? What happened to her? I can't believe that happened. That shouldn't have happened, or something like that. And I noticed that those thoughts, there was like a hint, like I said, like maybe about 5 or 8% level of like a little bit of sadness, like Eeyore kind of a feeling. And then I noticed stuff that Dr. Connolly had said to me in the session and that I had repeated after him, like other ways of thinking that he had taught me when those thoughts happen, they automatically like came up in response to those thoughts. In almost like a brick wall, the thoughts stopped. it was like it intersected them like at a highway intersection like that. And it was like Gandalf and Lord of the Rings, no further. It was like I was observing that. And then I noticed that it was like 100% again, like no depression, no sadness, no anger, and just peace and like happiness. And then I noticed, oh, my parents have made, I can smell like bacon and coffee and eggs for breakfast. And I was clear and right back in the moment. And to this day, I like can't get the sadness or the anger or the guilt back if I try. Like if you tried to pay me money, I can't feel it.
That's so good.
That's what I thought I should tell people about it. So I've been seizure-free, like symptom-free. I mean, used to having panic attacks. I haven't had another nightmare about all that stuff. It's, what will it be? So like at least 15 years now.
Wow. So,
like 4 months later, I sent Dr. Connolly a thank you letter describing how much he had changed my life and how I can't wait to get my driver's license back and work and be able to earn a living. And I would really love to learn how to do what he does for people. And he was like, well, that would be great. Why don't you come learn from me? And so he responded to that. And he's been my mentor and dear personal friend. And I've been training with him ever since. And so I've seen now over 4,000 clients helping clear trauma. And I, within 1 year after the TED Talk, within that next year, in the year 2014, I survived a pretty brutal rape from a psychopath, from somebody who drugged my drink, somebody who I met from a business networking meetup. I had known and hung out with him and other people that knew him for like 3 months on a certain night of the week. And then I thought we were going to be meeting up to hang out with other people, and he showed up by himself. And pretty quickly, I ended up not feeling well. And then, so when that happened, I reached out to Dr. Connolly again for treatment. And I got my first session to clear that sexual assault up 5 days after the sexual assault had happened. And the PTSD was so bad, even within those 5 days, my body had like broken out in hives. I was starting to experience disordered eating, like fears of seeing my own body naked, like having a hard time being able to bathe, see myself in the mirror, stuff like that. Which, I mean, there was all kinds of very dysfunctional thoughts and feelings that occurred from that. Like being mad that I was a woman and had a body, being mad at men, being mad at penises. Like, I mean, I was having a PTSD reaction at the, even like the statue of David. It is bad. So
I get that you're pissed off. Somebody,
I really was, yes.
And you don't do that.
And so he did it again, and he like got permission to clear up the anger and the trauma, like again. And I maybe had, maybe over time, like to clear up different things, because I went to the police and I was trying to get a criminal trial to happen. My rape kit got lost, which was awesome. And yeah, so he ended up, we had between him and another very advanced RRT specialist, her name is Dr. Lydia Glass, practicing in California. I had some sessions with her. She helped me study up on sociopaths and how to spot them and how to respond to them. And psychopaths and stuff like that. And so I don't know, like about 6 sessions later, I felt well enough. I wasn't having a bunch of dysfunction after that rape. And then unfortunately I got raped again.
Somebody else. No.
That happened in 2016 with somebody that I was very, very close to that was very, very much a skilled con artist predator. He had been using he was covering up his dysfunction with saying that he had Asperger's. So it was like, okay, if he sometimes acted like an asshole and pressed boundaries. And there was like this tiptoe dance of making people feel very, very comfortable with him, him being a very loving, kind, caring human being, but it was an act. And then, you know, sometimes like doing things that pressed a boundary or something like that. And like one day while he was helping me bandage a very horrible dog bite on my leg, then he assaulted me. And I found out the next day, a couple of friends that we were all mutual friends, two girls called me and they said, we know you're very, very close with this guy and that he lives not that far from you. We want to let you know that today we're having an intervention with him because some people have been reporting that he's assaulted them and that they hadn't felt comfortable to share it because they didn't think anybody would believe them. But we all discussed it with like a counselor who says that he is a sexual predator. And we're going to basically tell him that we're all going to like press charges. And I immediately told them what happened to me and I went to the police again. And I did win a civil protection order, a sexual assault restraint against him. And anyway, Dr. Connolly and the Breathless Therapy community helped clear that one up again. My husband ended up writing a book, by the way, called When Your Partner Says Hashtag Me Too, from all of the stuff that he learned from being a partner to me when I was dealing with the trauma from the sexual assaults. And since the impact during the times while I was getting treatment, there was times where I was dealing with PTSD symptoms, and if clients reached out to me for rapid resolution therapy or hypnotherapy to help clear their own sexual assault traumas, I was having to refer that to other people to not re-trigger myself. But now I'm so like clear and solid that somebody can tell me, you know, they're like, I can assist survivors of sexual violence and domestic violence and stuff like that without getting re-triggered. And I've been getting even better results with it because of knowing what it was like to be dealing with that myself, and because of getting so much great treatment for that, that it's like actually one of the things that I feel it's most rewarding to assist people with, to make sure that they don't have to suffer from things like I had, for instance, pelvic floor dysfunction. I don't know if you've ever heard of that, but there was like pain during sex, vaginismus. My body had even developed like really bad fibroids and stuff like that, like bad period pain. And the treatment ended up helping clear that up because like it had caused hormonal imbalances from the stress of it. And I'm like healthier now and my body like feels better. And I'm able to enjoy all kinds of sexual acts with my husband without having PTSD anymore because of other people's bad behavior, which is awesome.
Well, that helps for sure. Yeah. So here's a mind blower. I've had Sean on my podcast. The dog bite and Asperger's light bulb went on. I'm like, no shit.
Well, that's so funny. I didn't even. Well, I think that's neat. Small world.
Right? No, that's great. He was like one of my first like 10 interviews, I want to say. But it was amazing how he wanted to get help to be there for you.
Like, I'm so grateful. Beautiful. I mean, because what can happen is if a survivor is dealing with PTSD and they're trying to get that resolved and gain progress in their life and, you know, heal, if their partner isn't really skilled at supporting that process and they get triggered a lot themselves, like they end up feeling resentment or shame or something like that, if a survivor has a PTSD reaction during intimacy and they have their own triggered response and they're not really helpful at being like grounded and calming and like helping the survivor feel like, hey, it's okay that this happened. Like nothing, you haven't done anything wrong. It's fine. You know what I mean? Like it can be really re-traumatizing. It can make somebody feel like their mind can interpret it as being broken and that things will never get better. And it, depending on how somebody reacts in those moments, it can be like absolutely counterproductive to the healing process.
I totally can see that. Correct. Because your brain sometimes cannot compartmentalize. I cannot talk.
Compartmentalize. Yeah.
Yeah. But yeah, like it's, you're in the act again, but it doesn't know probably who's doing it. And you know, like, is this acceptable? Is this okay? Is this safe?
Right. And exactly. So your
mind just goes into freaking fight mode to where it's just,
yeah. And so like, in, even if somebody tries like to kind of push and coerce or manipulate a little bit, like, hey, I mean, somebody might have the best of intentions of like, but it's me. It's not that guy. Like, I want to make, you're safe with me. I want to make you feel good. Like, it's okay to keep going. And if they can, like, sometimes going slower at first can make the whole recovery process much quicker, right? Like, of not pushing when, before somebody's ready, and like taking things a bite-sized piece at a time, like in the way that helps the survivor feel really empowered and comfortable. Like, for instance, if, let's say I hadn't gotten a chance to clear triggers yet in a rapid resolution therapy session of like my, how certain smells or textures or something like that, you know, the reaction happening, it's like, well, doing things in the shower, you know, like with aromatherapy, or being extra, you know, like going the above and the extra mile with hygiene and stuff like that to make sure that things are, while you're in this recovery process, as like pleasurable and gentle as possible and not like overdoing it, is great, right? And I'm just so thankful that I've had so much support through the different traumas that I've survived between loved ones and also very effective trauma clearing specialists. So that's what I recommend to people. It's a part of the rapid resolution therapy community values and like guidelines that if you are a rapid resolution therapy facilitator or specialist, and a specialist is somebody who's had hundreds of hours of training and like mentorship and supervision. So we definitely recommend that people dealing with pretty intense trauma work with an RRT specialist. But it's a part of our community values that we provide pro bono treatment for survivors of sexual violence if they cannot afford their mental health treatment. So everybody is required to do so many, you know, pro bono hours, or help refer somebody out to somebody who can afford to do a rate that's within that person's budget, or work pro bono if somebody's pro bono and discounted slots are like filled up that month. We try to find somebody that can afford to give you the treatment that you need. And there is a nonprofit called Institute for Survivors of Sexual Violence, an actual 501c3 that Dr. Connolly, Rapid Resolution Therapy, like put together, that like if you donate to it, it goes to providing pro bono treatment for survivors of sexual violence and training those survivors once they're clear to be able to become rapid resolution therapy practitioners themselves if they would like to. And so they get scholarships for learning how to be healers themselves.
I love that.
Yeah.
Love that. That's great.
That's, yeah, really, I'm a big fan. Yeah.
Yeah, I can totally see that. I mean, it pretty much, it gave you back your life numerous times.
Oh, so, like, I would not be here today. Who knows? I mean, I have survived a suicide attempt because of the trauma, right? Like, I can honestly say that I'm thriving. And I believe, you know, that a lot of it is like grace, a power beyond ourselves, like whatever the source of love and intelligence and well-being is. I mean, there was a level of the stuff that I went through that caused me to have spiritual trauma, right? And be like questioning all kinds of things. But this getting PTSD treated on a physical level first helped restore my sense of, I guess you could call it, like, almost like spirituality. Like feeling like I'm not experiencing confusion or anger and a sense of where do I stand with God and stuff like that and everything. I feel that I have a way of looking at how the world is working and how trauma happens and pain and things happen without being angry and in grief about it all the time. I have peace, and my mind is trained to go, well, my mind has been trained, like, the first intention of rapid resolution therapy is to get somebody's mind to the point to where they are entertaining thoughts and opportunities and behaviors that are of value, things that are possible to do and would be good to have done. So it is a waste of my time and my energy to try to solve the whole entire world's problems, to put myself in the position of God, to think of it as my responsibility to prevent pain from happening. Like, if Jesus Christ and the Dalai Lama and Martin Luther King Jr. and Mahatma Gandhi and all, you know, Mother Teresa have walked the face of the earth and they didn't solve it. If you gave me the task of becoming God to go, hey, how can you make everybody, like, grow and learn and evolve and learn what really matters in life and be happy? And by the way, also figure out how to make sure nobody ever experiences any risk or vulnerability or pain, illness, tragedy, no growing pains. Figure out how to make it all fair from the dawn of time or now. Where would you begin? I don't know. So, nope. Not going to waste any time on that. If there is something that I can do to make my own life better or other people's lives around me, something in my immediate vicinity better, if I can advocate for a cause and I can do that with joy and gratitude and, like, be grateful to be doing it and not be in a constant state of mourning and anger and fear and stuff, but just be like, hey, do I need to run, hide, or play sick or dead or bite anybody? Which is, like, where those sadness and anger and fear is coming from, as the body trying to cause some kind of very specific primal action to occur. And when you go through RRT, it's the facilitator's job to cause your mind and your body to, like, hey, stop that. Stop that emotional, that physiological, biological response trying to do these old things like run, hide, play sick or dead, bite. And, you know, use your prefrontal cortex, your higher thinking brain, to take a look at things. Live from that. Like, and we make that adjustment happen. And I can promise people that it works a lot better. Like, I had to, there was twice from the two traumas, the sexual assaults that I survived, there was a time where I was suffering from, like, grief and resentment at the state of the world, being, like, really pissed off that sexual violence is, like, a horrible epidemic, that the justice system is, like, utter failure at, like, doing, trying to do things, I don't know, to prevent it or to rehabilitate and hold people accountable and stop sexual predators and, like, and Dr. Connolly, like, lovingly, respectfully, tactfully wrestled that preoccupation and dysfunction and disturbance away from me to go, you're actually going to be a better advocate. Like, this was a part of our intention in that session where I had debilitating back pain because my first sexual assault had happened in within a 4-month period where, like, I had had a car accident that was no fault. Somebody ran into me, got sexually assaulted, and a couple months later had survived another car accident where somebody rear-ended me and then somebody T-boned me. So during that time, I'd had, like, really bad back pain. And when the Me Too movement fired off and, like, the Access Hollywood tape with Donald Trump, I started having back pain again, even though I got checked out and my back was fine, but I was having debilitating back pain. And when I had a session with Dr. Connolly about that, like, during the Kristin Blasey, right? Is that how you say her name? Like the Brett Kavanaugh?
I believe so.
Right, when Brett Kavanaugh was getting interviewed or whatever to be a Supreme Court justice, and Dr. Christine Blasey Ford, I think is her name, like testified about her own sexual assault. I had heard that in the news one day, like walking by a cafe it was on, and I heard people talking about it. And that's when my back pain got triggered. And I started feeling, one hour later, I couldn't walk. I had that much back pain.
Wow.
And I was seen by doctors and they couldn't figure out why I was having the back pain. So I had a phone session with Dr. Connolly, and we realized that it was because of the, again, like sexual assault, grief and anger being triggered in my body because of body memory of what had happened from the original sexual assault that I had. And a part of that intention was that I would be healthier and stronger and more free and clear, that my mind, I could talk about things that are totally fucked up, but not be feeling any disturbance in my digestive system, my immune system, my mental clarity, and my mood. And I could do things that would be useful, but without suffering. And literally, like this today, this conversation I'm having with you is a part of that vision of an intention in that session that I had years ago. I don't want to suffer every time I see Donald Trump's face and think about shit that he's done. You know what I mean? Like,
no, because unfortunately we see too much of his face. So.
Yeah, exactly. So seeing it on a physical level is not to my advantage in any way.
No, shit. His face is on cars, on you can't escape it. He's like riding in the back seat of somebody's car. Like,
I don't know. I wish they were being at peace and laughing about it rather than like having debilitating back pain.
Absolutely. So somebody who's going through trauma themselves, do you think, like, instead of obviously burying it and trying to bury it and it doesn't exist, go face it head on, because do you think by you ignoring it so long is why you got to the seizures and all that?
Absolutely. Like, I can see why trying to focus on something else, like, that is an adaptation strategy, it's a survival strategy. But if that stuff is like, oh my gosh, I'm starting to notice my sleep is being disturbed, I'm starting to notice my appetite is being disturbed, I'm starting to notice sensations in my body, like it's causing a physical, emotional reaction in my body. When those emotions are happening, because the body is setting up for very specific primal actions of running and hiding and playing sick or dead or biting, it's interfering with immune system, that like digestion, mental clarity, mood, energy, it's not prioritizing healing in the body. And if that continues to happen over time, it will have a cumulative effect. Like, it will have an impact on the nervous system, and it doesn't need to be that way. You can get effective treatment sooner. A lot of times people just don't know, well, who's getting good results. So I can tell you that the rapid resolution therapy does get good results with clearing trauma. I'm not saying that everybody that says they practice rapid resolution therapy is getting good results for certain kinds of things, symptoms somebody is dealing with. That's why you ask the person. You are like calling up and checking out and go, hey, how many sessions have you noticed anybody with a similar story to mine, similar symptoms? How many sessions has it usually taken for them to experience relief from the symptoms that, like, I have? The rapid resolution therapy answer should be within 1 to 4. Or if there's very complex trauma and there's extra health issues going on, like if somebody is dealing with PTSD on top of a traumatic brain injury, like a concussion, or toxic mold syndrome, or Lyme's disease, or food allergies and stuff like that, other things that can contribute to anxiety symptoms and stuff that interferes with mood and energy and digestion system functioning, those things will need to be getting treated at the same time for somebody to be experiencing more dramatic results that hold up over time with addressing clearing trauma or negative thought patterns, ways of thinking that don't serve a person, or clearing up the impact from prior experiences. And so you want to be able to tell somebody, you know, these are symptoms I've been having. This is what I have already done. Like, I've tried these other therapies, or I'm being seen by my doctor about this. I'm also treating the symptoms this way. What could I expect from working with you? What is a session typically like? Like, what kinds of processes would you use to help clear up these symptoms? And if it all makes sense to you and you get a good feeling about that person, that they seem like they are competent and they have good experience at getting good results for people, then I say, like, you know, try it out and see what happens. You got nothing
to lose. Exactly. Like,
right.
No brainer in my eyes.
Yeah, right. You want life to be better and your health to be better? If you want to get back, because it's like, it's bad enough that bad things happen in life, but for somebody else to suffer the consequences of the crazy stuff that happens in this world and other like crazy behavior from other people, it's like, you know, give the gift to yourself. Like, there was a time where I was resentful that I was having to take time to have therapy. Like, either after the car accident, so yeah, whether it's physical therapy, chiropractic, like, I'm spending money on this, like, getting more rapid resolution therapy sessions or something like that. And Dr. Connolly told me in a session, he's like, if a friend asked you to help them clean up their house because people broke into it and trashed it, would you tell that friend, oh God, I'm resentful and pissed off and sad that I have to take time out of my day to help you with this? No. You'd be like grateful that the person had like asked you to help them out, right? And it's like, what else is money good for than to like help yourself feel better? Like, it's the gift that you give yourself. If you can think about it as being your own best friend, your own best caretaker, like, hey, I will not let the thought of like, man, I wish I didn't have to do this. It's not my fault that this happened to me. Other people, you know, should be having to pay for this. I don't want to have to do it myself. I will not let that thought get in the way of me feeling better. I will do, because it's my responsibility and it's my opportunity to get myself feeling better. If I delegate it and make it other people's responsibility, I'm disempowered.
And it's never going to happen.
I could be waiting until the cows. I don't know what it means to say until the cows come home, because I'm not a farmer or anything, but I think that.
No, it has to start with you, because you have to want it. You have to accept it. You have to work towards it. If I say, I want you to be better, I want you to do this, I want you to do that, that don't mean shit to you. Like, okay, you want me better. Great. So do I. But if you're not going to do the work to actually get better, then, I mean, there's no point.
Well, it's like when the second assault happened with a guy that had been like a friend, that I felt, one of the most insidious things about sexual assault trauma or abuse trauma, betrayal trauma, is like how it can, have an impact of making somebody feel ashamed, who's the victim, the survivor. And I got hung up for a while on thinking like, oh my God, I don't want to have to tell Dr. Connolly or anybody in the rapid resolution therapy again that this happened to me again. They're going to think I'm an idiot, somebody who like wants to go looking for trauma and have drama in my life or something like that. And so for a while, I tried to do other things to help myself, because I was like, self-conscious about asking for help with clearing up another sexual violence trauma. And my husband lovingly and patiently did his best to support me during that time. And eventually he was like, babe, I care about you. And I see that this is taking like slower and, you're still having difficulty and you know that this other modality really works very quickly and well for you. And maybe while you stopped having seizures, maybe we should do that one again for the second sexual assault trauma. I have a few sessions about this. And I had to go, okay, I can tell it's affecting the relationship with my husband. Like, I was getting more defensive, like sensitive to tones of anger. I was almost overcompensating. I was like, I'm going to be more alpha than you because I don't want, like, I don't know if you, like,
no, that it makes would. Little sense because you didn't have the power then. So right. Now I'm going to have the power. I'm
yeah. taking over. It was like I was seeing him more as a threat of being a man or expressing some fleeting feelings of being upset at me, but I was more sensitive to it. And instead of even feeling, I guess in one way it was like I felt fear, but then it just skipped right into like be more angry than him. It's come across as more powerful or angry than him and stuff, right? Like I ain't got to take that from no man. Man have done enough for me. And I realized, I was like, this is, you know, that guy, like, my husband didn't rape me. He's always treated me with kindness and respect and stuff like that. And so I was like, yeah, you're right. Like, I don't want this to mess up my life anymore. And as soon as I got treatment, like, I felt better. So.
It's just, I'm so happy that you guys were able to find Dr. Connolly and he was able to work with you and see what's possible. So many people are so closed-minded, and that's why I like to talk about these things on my show, because, I mean, there's help out there. It doesn't matter if you were homeless for, like, 30 years, you've been beaten, you've been raped numerous times, like, you've seen murder. Yeah, that's all horrific, but yeah. You can still turn that around.
And it feels, during the time when you're in the distress, unfortunately, the thoughts are like, hey, this is like how the world is. And it's almost like thinking like my reaction to it is appropriate or I need it or it's useful or something like that. Like I have to, like it at that time when you're suffering from the PTSD, it feels like it makes sense to have the fear and the anger and the grief and the depression or the hopelessness. Like those thoughts seem true. But it's like, what I recommend to people, because of my experience of knowing what it was like to be on the shitty side of the grass on the fence, like things really aren't working well and you're very distressed, versus on the other side of the fence of getting effective trauma clearing treatment done. It's like my mind is trained from having been somebody that survived it and also now being a healer, a facilitator, a practitioner, when thoughts cross my mind, I think, or even let's say opportunities of an action that I could take, my mind evaluates it by going, if I were to continue to think this thought, if I were to believe it, if I were to continue indulging it and entertaining it and let it become a habit, a pattern for me to think this way, what results is it likely to get me? How will it affect my health, my relationships, my finances? You know, what opportunities might I miss if I were to continue believing and thinking this way? It's not even anymore about, is it true? It's like, is it useful? Is it advantageous? And if I think, well, what could happen if I start thinking this way, even if I don't feel that it's true yet? But if, like, I hear a good podcast or, you know, like, you're, like, if I believe this survivor, if I entertain what this facilitator, this healer, this therapist is saying to me, what would life be like if I now think that way, if I react and respond and behave that way, if my habits become that way, how could it make my life better? That's one way that even if things don't even feel real or true, it's like, I don't know how to make myself feel or think that way. First, start asking, what is the thoughts that you're having? Are they useful or not? Should we follow that thought and listen to it? You know, like the angel and devil on our shoulder or something like that. Like, which one is going to lead you to a better, you don't even have to feel like it's real anymore. Just like, notice what happens if you follow a useful thought.
For sure. I mean, thoughts become things, right? So right. The more positivity, the more you put out there, because if you're negative all the time, all you're going to do is attract negativity. Negative things are going to happen to you because that's all you concentrate on. So you bring it to you. Start being positive, start having a positive outcome, and you will see so many more opportunities open up for you. It's really, it's up to you to make the changes that you want. Be the change in yourself.
That's beautiful. Yeah. Be the change you wish to see. I know that sometimes people have been disturbed by this feeling of like, well, it seemed like in my life when something good started to happen, then something bad started to happen. So I'm almost like a superstitious thought. Like if I try to get better, or maybe it's like even like I don't deserve it, or guilt or shame, like maybe I deserve to be suffering, or like it won't last. Like life is suffering and it'll get taken away. It doesn't even make sense to try anymore to be happy. Again, those thoughts are from trauma, and they are from the impact of experiences of ways of thinking you were exposed to in childhood. And there are professionals that can clear that way of thinking up for you, because I promise that that is not making life better for you.
Me too. And I'm not even trained.
You've been following the useful thoughts. Mine has been finding a useful way of living. It's way to go if you can figure that out. If you've figured it out all on your own, more power to you. That's awesome. And right, but like if you need assistance, if you could use some assistance, because it's like, but I'm still suffering from negative thoughts. Like maybe kind of like somebody brings their car to a mechanic or their laptop to a technician. There are people that can help if you can't figure it out on your own.
Exactly. And well, that's what these modalities are here for, to show right. you the way. Because, I mean, a lot of people probably think it's like woo-woo shit. Well, then give it a try and tell me, is it still woo-woo? Because no. A lot of people swear by it. So exactly. What do you have to lose?
Yeah. It's like, okay, well, you gave it a try. And that was a worthwhile way to go on you for trying something, even if you didn't get all the results you were looking for immediately. Like, that's why you want to ask a new facilitator or therapist of a certain kind of modality, whether it's EMDR or whatever, you know, rapid resolution therapy or something. It's like, how many treatments should I actually even give this a try to start seeing whether it's like actually getting results and being effective? Like, what is the investment? Like, I'm willing to understand that I might not get all of my desired results before treatment has fully, you know, concluded, like going all the way. Like, some people, there might be variables, like some people respond sooner or slower than other people or something like that. But how many sessions to at least see if it's a good fit? If there's some kind of amount of progress, what's the budget of my time and investment for that? And for RRT, it's 1 to 4 sessions.
To roll the die to have one session and walk out there skipping and jumping and being like living your best life. I mean,
yeah. Again, that's why I'm trying to let people know about it. So.
I get it. You're not spending 5 years on someone's couch going, right? You know, talking about the same shit every session. It's, you got to move past it. And now there are quicker ways. Talk therapy, don't get me wrong, it's great. But if you need to move a little quicker, you might want to look into some other things.
I was going to say, like, the other therapist that I had sessions with before I met Dr. Connolly, having somebody listen to and like be supportive and like help you feel, you know, like at least you're not alone. Like, it was nice while I was going through distress. Those people didn't even claim to know how to help me like feel better. So they weren't liars. They were supportive, you know? And I'm glad that I had somebody to talk to while I was in such a state of distress. But checking to see, hey, can you actually clear up these symptoms? Like, one of the therapists that I had seen before Dr. Conley about, like, grief trauma, which this is a very popular way of thinking and the opposite of the rapid resolution therapy way of thinking, but it was kind of like the solution to traumatic grief is to get more comfortable with grieving. Like, just be okay that you're going to grieve. Grieve more. And so that person, when I said I'm having anger towards the drunk driver, they were like, you know what? You need to be okay. Get used to feeling angry. And, like, your homework assignment is to beat like a pillow or a couch or something like that for 10 minutes a day with a bat. Yeah, anyway, so it was like exercising. It was like strengthening the anger.
Right?
Now, I'm sure that's based on that person's training or maybe something that was personally helpful for them or something like that had the opposite effect on me.
You know what I
mean? So, like, that's unfortunately what a lot of people end up encountering. And if it's like, man, if things get worse after a session with somebody, immediately discontinue. You know what I mean?
Sure, yes. And that's another thing, like, I try to tell my listeners so much, like, if the first one doesn't work for you, there are more. There are others. Don't be like, oh, I'm unfixable or I'm broken. Right? No, they just weren't a good fit. Go find another one.
Yeah, it might even be within the same modality. There's a different, like, a facilitator that actually is more competent and experienced at it. That's why I definitely ask people to do not do it unless you've had a consult or you've, like, looked at reviews. You have talked to somebody else that saw that person and got good results. Do not re-traumatize yourself with, like, ineffective people.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
I get that. If somebody wants to work with you, what is the best way for them to find you?
Yeah, KristinRivas.com. So I'll spell my name. It might be in the show notes or whatever, but it's KristinRivas. And then my last name is Rivas, which is R-I-V as in Victor, A-S, KristinRivas.com.
And when you're there, you can get...
Oh, yeah.
I downloaded this because I'm like, I need this in my life.
That's a guideline to managing emotions.
Emotions. Fuck yeah.
I'm excited about it too. So, yeah, like when people come to see me, I have a library of resources to offer them to boost their emotional intelligence and self-regulation skills. People like a full guided meditation library, videos on how to get out of fight, flight, freeze emotions and into more resourceful states like security, serenity, empowerment, love, and gratitude. And I like journaling exercises and stuff for people to use in addition to the heavy lifting I do in sessions to rewire their neural pathways and retrain their nervous system. There are some people that they're like, oh my God, I hate doing homework. I've done enough of that for the rest of my life. And fine. There are some people that love doing that, right? It's like, I have it available for people if they think that it would be useful, they can check it out. But my job in a session is to clear up a way of thinking that's been disturbing them, like that a certain thought doesn't seem true anymore, that they can't get a disturbing feeling to come up from a memory or imagining something. Like, I've neutralized triggers for them as much as I possibly can within every single session. And there are some things that I can suggest to people as a brain health coach, like, of things that, like, adjunct things that they can be doing to improve their brain health, their hormone health, their digestive health, protect progress we've been making in sessions. But I am trained to do my job in such a way that that stuff would not be necessary. Of, like, meaning that if we don't do it, we can't experience any progress. I'm trained to put the responsibility on me to be as effective as possible. If I said I could get you results with clearing up some symptoms, I'm going to use RRT to do that.
Yeah, it works and it doesn't take forever.
Exactly. Nice.
Yeah. Was there anything else you wanted to add?
Yeah, people do feel free to reach out, whether you check out my website, kristinrivas.com, or like I said, cleartrauma.com or rapidresolutiontherapy.com. If you go to rapidresolutiontherapy.com, I think there's something that might say, I can't remember what the menu says, of like sessions or treatments. And you can look at specialists that might be in your area or people that can do it over telehealth or Zoom and stuff like that. So might as well check it out.
Absolutely. Do you do only in person or do you do Zoom as well? How do you manage your clients?
Yeah, so I have been doing mainly telehealth and Zoom or even the phone. In some cases, I do arrange in-person treatment for people these days. I moved and I'm going to move again. And so it's been hard to like get an office and then, you know, the pandemic and stuff like that. Since the TED Talk hit, which is, by the way, called Kristin Rivas, TEDx Rainier, The Life-Changing Power of Words is the name of that. I got used to working with a lot of people all over the country or the world, you know, because there were people that couldn't find RRT practitioners or hypnotherapists or effective therapists where they were, like in Dubai or something. So, like, I got used to doing it that way. I will tell people after I consult with them if I think that they should work with somebody face-to-face, local, and see whether we can arrange it between us or whether we can get somebody else that can see them sooner. So.
Perfect. That's great. Well, thank you so much, Kristin. I really enjoyed this conversation.
I did too. Thank you so much, Tiffany, for creating this community, this education, this platform, and giving people the opportunity to share how their life got better and inspire other people and make the world a better place. Thank you so much.
I'm trying.
You're succeeding.
Yeah. That's right. Well, perfect. All right.